Hello and welcome to our analysis of iCAT 18, part of our All India National Level CAT Test Series for CAT 2018. In the first part of this analysis, we had looked at the verbal ability section and seen how it was a moderately difficult section in a moderately difficult mock. In this part, we look at the toughest section of this mock, which is DILR. Before we move on to DILR, we first need to see that the overall mock at an average LOD of somewhere around 1.85, whereas CAT would possibly be somewhere around 1.9. What this means is that when I assign an LOD or a difficulty level of 1 to an easy question and 3 to a tough question, this is the average difficulty level that I get per question for this mock. Now when I apply the same parameter to DILR, I observe that the average LOD in DILR was above moderate at somewhere around 2.13. In CAT, we have seen this value go to close to 2.2 or 2.25, which means that this section was slightly easier or reasonably easier compared to CAT, but still the most difficult section as far as this mock was concerned. Now, how do we analyze DILR? In verbal, we've seen that we look at RC and non-RC separately. For the RCs, we look at various parameters such as the word length, the area, I mean the subject area of the RC, the number of questions, etc. In DILR, some of these parameters do not matter. For instance, it is known for a fact that DILR will always have 8 sets of 4 questions each. Now, when this is the case, we always tell students that you need to try and attempt at least 16 questions or 4 sets for any standard CAT mock, which is somewhere around this difficulty level of 2.2. We also tell students, however, that if the difficulty level goes up, then if the difficulty level goes up, then the number of questions to be attempted can go down to somewhere around 12 to 13 as well, which means a little more than 3 attempts. On the other hand, if the difficulty level goes down, your number of attempts should increase and you should try and target 5 sets, which is anywhere close to 20 questions. Now, in this particular mock, as we've been saying, it was slightly easier compared to the actual CAT. So, I would have targeted 5 sets, but the key in DILR is to select the best 4 or 5 sets. Now, very often, like in RC, the definition of best changes from person to person. However, there are certain sets which need to be attempted in a mock by everybody so as to give yourself the best chance of clearing the cutoff. Now, how do we ensure that, or how do we do that? So, at a very basic level, we look at the average difficulty of each set with respect to that section. As we said, we looked at the average difficulty of the section and saw that it was 2.13. Now, this very simple graph which maps the average LOD of each set clearly tells me which my two toughest sets were. So, there was one set which was on a Venn diagram based on 4 parameters. It was a 4 set Venn, genuinely difficult set. And then there was one on insurance companies which was a bar graph. The difficulty with this was that you needed to understand correctly what the bar graph said. If you didn't understand, you just wouldn't have been able to solve the set. In the case of the Venn diagram, it was a case where even if you had understood, you would still have found it difficult to actually solve this set. So these two were sets that I as a student would definitely would have avoided in the exam. Having said that, I would still say that these two were sets that should have been practiced at home. So they were very good sets to improve your overall DILR, but from an exam point of view, these were sets that I might not have attempted in the exam. Now coming to the remaining 6 sets. When I look at these other sets, I'll start with the easiest one, which was the one on the GDP. Now this was a set which would be more suited to an IIFT than to a CAT, because it has some aspects of calculation involved, and now with the calculator being in place, this becomes easy to do. So the other aspect that is important here is that all the questions in this particular set were MCQs. This made it far easier because I had options, I could validate my answer. Hence, when I look at these two, three parameters, I observe that this is the set that I would have definitely attempted. Similarly, there was a matrix, and generally I tell students that matrix is something that you should practice because there you at least have an idea of how to start. So here there was an 8x4 matrix on IPL. Again, it was an MCQ, and the overall difficulty, as you can see, was below moderate or below the section. Generally, the beauty of an MCQ is that once you solve the first question properly, you might be able to answer all the other questions well. So this is something that I would have definitely solved once again. Then there was another question on a photo shoot. This was based on scheduling various people for the photo shoot on various days. Again, advantage MCQ, scheduling, so you know what is to be done. This is one more set that I would have definitely attempted. Now coming to the next three sets. So these are the three sets which every student should have tried. But now coming to the other three sets, let me describe these for you. These two, the one on time and work and the one on five parties, were actually based on mathematical concepts. So the one on time and work was actually like a time and work question, or two time and work questions combined with each other and asked to you. There were a couple of complications. Had you understood what is happening and done it with patience, the key word for this set was patience. Had you done it with patience, not tried to go very fast, not tried to apply mathematical shortcuts, you would have got the right answer. Otherwise, there was a 100% chance that you would have gone wrong. And the other reason for this, and that is where I would say that this was a trap also, was that it was a completely theta or numerical entry set. So the problem that you would have faced is that whatever you would get as the right answer, you might have ended up believing that that was indeed the right answer. So this set could have been solved, but it required a lot of patience, as I said, and a lot of confidence in your right answer. On the other hand, when I look at the one on multiple parties, essentially this was a set on probability. So you had five people making probabilities for each of those cases, and then you had to apply probability and get the answer. Technically, this was a simple set, but a lot of students find probability to be on the tougher side. Also, there would have been some students who would have seen some four or five tables in this particular set and left it, just thinking that how do I solve so much data? So that is where again this particular set might have created an issue. But having said that, it was still a doable set. Finally, when I moved to this last one, which was based on power plants, in a lot of ways it was fairly easy, but it involved the concept of efficiency and maxima minima, so there students had to be a little careful. I would say that in an exam scenario, solving one or two questions out of four would have been a good strategy as far as this particular set is concerned. So as a student, what are the sets that I would have attempted? Definitely the one on multiple line GDP, the one on matrix, the one on photo shoot. Then I would have gone to the one on probability, and then tried to do the set on time and work. If I had time after that, I might have potentially come to the one on power plants. But I would have definitely not touched the two sets on insurance companies and the four set Venn diagram. Now, just as we did in RC, we also need to look at the actual difficulty level of each question before we go to the questions themselves. So as you can see here, in DILR, there is generally not much of an analysis that can be done for actual difficulty level. But you can see in certain cases, as I said, for instance, in time and work, if you understood the logic in the first question correctly, everything else could be done. The one on scheduling, as I said, was fairly simple. The one on multiple table, fairly simple. The matrix. The one on power plants, again, here there was this complication. So as I said, the first understanding was important. Had you done this, both of these would have been a cakewalk. But again, the last question was on the tougher side. So as a student, I might have solved this, understood it, done these two, left the last question. On the other hand, this last set, purely easy to moderate. Contrary to this, when I look at the one on insurance or when I look at the one on when, they are definitely on the tougher side. So this just validates what we said and gives me greater clarity in terms of my strategy that yes, I would have attempted this in full, potentially I would have tried to do this completely, and then maybe one of these two could have been done partially. Let's have a look at these actual sets and arrive at certain conclusions. So, for the very first set, just one bar graph, so that appears simple, but you notice that there is some aspect of when. A survey was carried out on 100 people to assess the acceptability of players. Each respondent was given a sheet where four companies were evaluated for three parameters. So there are three parameters here for four companies. Each respondent had to select exactly one parameter for any one company that he found acceptable. So here the key is to understand what this graph says. The numbers are very easy to read, but you need to know what this number says. Essentially, this 6 for reliability against company 1 means that there were 6 people who felt that the reliability of company 1. Now, I don't know which of C1, and I don't know that 1 does not necessarily represent C1. So, reliability of company 1 was what he found best. Similarly, every single respondent gave one such answer. If you notice, the total of these numbers will come to 100, which means every respondent had some different combination. This is like a collection of tally marks. You essentially have 12 parameters here or 12 options here. Reliability of C1, reliability of C2, reliability of C3, so on up to ethical sales of C4. So you have 12 parameters. Each respondent selects one out of these 12, and then that is tabulated here. Now the other complication is 1 does not necessarily represent C1. So that's one. The second complication is the three parameters of 1 may not necessarily correspond to the same company, which means here this could correspond to C1, this could correspond to C2. So again, you need to match and map everything and then arrive at an answer. Plus, if you read a graph like this, you need to be aware that there will 100% be some clues that help you arrive at answers. Total respondents accepting C2 and C4, so on. C3 had equal respondents accepting it on at least two parameters. So you have certain clues based on which you need to identify the various parameters for each company. You need to find all those 12 values. When you look at the questions, you notice that you do not have absolute questions. What could be the total points? If 5 respondents this, what could be this? If something happened, what would be the difference? So you notice that all the questions are conditional. Also, you are not going to get actual values. Which of the following combinations of statements can be true? So again, this is a combination, which means that you are going to get multiple cases of parameters mapping against each company, and that you will need to have on paper and then try to answer each question. So this is exactly the kind of question that I would love to solve at home and strengthen my DILR, but definitely not the question that I would attempt in the exam. On the other hand, when I look at the second set, I observe that this is a standard time and work set. It says that the table gives, so the table is easy to read, that the table gives the number of days required by a worker to complete a task. Two tasks are to be completed and each task consists of some work. So there's a task which has work. Task 1 has work A and work C. Task 2 has work B followed by work C. Now task, so here you need to really start classifying. that when I say task 1, I have Abdul and Akram. Sorry, Abdul and Akram. Whereas when I have task 2, I have Hamid and Anwar. Also, task 1 involves A plus C, task 2 involves B plus C. So you need to note down these conditions. Then there are further conditions. All of them start the task together on the same day, same time. So that's obvious. Otherwise, you won't be able to solve the question. Anwar works for 2 days and then takes rest. He repeats this routine irrespective of tasks. So because you know that Anwar is matched with Hamid, look at the condition for Hamid. Hamid works on all days. So when I then draw a line graph, I essentially have Hamid working everywhere, whereas I have Anwar working for 2 days, then not working for 1 day, then again working for 2 days, not working for 1 day, and so on. This is how then I need to plot the number of units that are done by these two guys in so many number of days. Whereas Abdul and Akram work together for 2 days, after which Akram and Abdul independently and individually take rest. So if I have, let's say, Abdul and Akram, they independently and individually take rest on the 3rd and 4th day. So Akram takes rest on the 3rd day. So Abdul will be working here, then Akram will be working here. So here I have a 4-day cycle. Then it repeats. So you need to map these two cycles. So it's like saying there are two time and work questions. One based on Hamid and Anwar, one based on Abdul and Akram. And then answer the questions. The only glitch, as I said, is that this entire set is a theta or numerical entry set. So in that sense, you might not be able to really validate your answers. You would have to be very sure of what you've done. When I move on to the third set, the one that I said you should not attempt, the one on photo shoot. So this is fairly simple in understanding because you have 12 teams lined up for the week on 6 working days. The week starts from Monday, Sunday is a holiday. So you have a table. You know very clearly that I need to make a table from Monday to Saturday and 2 teams. So you have a Monday and 2 Saturday, 6 days here, 2 teams here. Then you'll have conditions that each team is represented by alternate letters. So you just list down 12 teams. Then you have certain teams available on certain days, certain teams who need to satisfy certain conditions. For the minute you read such a set, you realize that every question is going to be conditional and you'll have to apply a condition in each case and arrive at schedules. So if M is not available on Wednesday, how many ways can all the photo shoots be completed? So there will be some conditions that will always be fixed. For instance, team W is available only on the penultimate day. Now here you need to know the meaning of penultimate. Penultimate means second last. So team W has to be available on Friday. Then you start fitting everybody else. Q for Wednesday. Again, one condition, do something. Which of the following cannot be scheduled for Tuesday? Generally, you observe that in such sets that once you do one or two questions, you arrive at certain cases where you know that this team cannot work on this day. E on Monday. So every time you keep making cases and you'll get your answer. So fairly easy to do, might have been a little time consuming. The fourth set, the one that I said should not be done, is this one on the when's. You had a case where there was something in 14-15 and then there was something in 15-16. The big problem with this set, again pure theta. So even if you got the answer, you might just not have had any confidence to mark the answer. Definite no. The next set that we look at, the one on probability, people might have actually skipped this looking at the probability. Oh, 5 tables and there's probability and how do I do this? But if you understand the way this line, that the prediction from every mathematician turns out to be true, you realize that this entire set is based on one mathematical concept, which is known as expected value. So based on that, you find the probability of each particular party, you get the answer, and once you get the value, once you solve question one correctly, you get the value for each person. Every other question in this set can be answered pretty quickly. potentially the last question could have been skipped if you do not have time. If you're, let's say, doing this question right at the end, then you might have had to skip this because you might not have time to actually solve this. On the other hand, when I look at the next set, which is the one on IPL, looks like a longish set because the clues are given in a paragraph form rather than in a point form. But this is a straightforward classic set where I have 8 teams, 8 players, but from 6 different countries, and they're purchased at different prices. So you just need to keep matching things, make a table, get your answer. This is something that I would have definitely attempted. On the other hand, when I look at this one on power plants, this requires, it's a very short set, just this much data. But when I look at it, it requires understanding of the fact that there is energy utilization, which is actual energy utilization. Then there is installed capacity and capacity utilization. So you need to make one table. Here again, what happened was, if you solve this, everything else is answered pretty quickly. Finally, the last set that we discussed earlier, there's one on exports. So you have exports as a percentage of foreign trade. The question says foreign trade is exports or imports. So if exports is a certain percent, imports is the rest of it. You have foreign trade, so you can get the value of actual exports and imports. You have the calculator. The graph shows the GDP per capita, which means per head, and the population. So you can find the actual GDP. So in that sense, this is more like an IFT set. You understand these two things. You make a table for each of these 5 years. Use the calculator. This set is an absolute no-brainer. On the whole, if you were to ask me, this was an easier section compared to the typical DILR section that even we have been dishing out so far. 5 sets could definitely have been attempted here. 20 attempts might have been a reasonably good performance for this particular section. So if you were to ask me, I would say 20, yes. But even for an average student, 18 attempts would have been good. But on the whole, if you ask me, you should have ended up trying 5 sets. In part 3 of our analysis, we will look at the quant section. The video or the analysis for the first part, which is verbal, has already been put up on our YouTube channel. You can look at the videos for every analysis on our official YouTube channel given in the link. Click the bell button to receive a notification every time a new video is put up. You can also subscribe to our channel, like the videos, and comment on it with feedback or suggestions in the thread below the video. Wish you all the very best and do well in CAT.